Yes, thank you. I'm a bit hesitant to speak now about this topic because it indeed might offend this one or the other of yours. So see it as a very personal experience that I had and my answer to it, so not as the truth, and maybe we can discuss it then. I felt alienated in the last years with a number of with some conferences on some level. There were conferences, CAS conferences, critical animal studies conferences in Karlsruhe and in Vienna. And there were a number of speakers, and I don't say everybody there, but a number of speakers were inclined in a direction that I felt was completely contrary to my appreciation of this world and philosophy. A bit similar to this last effective altruism conference in Berlin, while there is a lot that was happening there and being discussed there that is obviously very positive, and I'm sure we will talk about this on the plenary tomorrow, there was aspects that were alienating me. So what is that? What did alienate me? So with the Critical Animal Studies conference, there was this general mood that there are concepts like time and consciousness and free will and autonomy that are specifically human. And it seems to be that those people had the opinion that reality based on those concepts is just a human convention. So that an animal per se, like a dog, doesn't experience time, but it's in our conception of the animal that experiences time. And in my view, that takes everything away from this animal. This is such a radical anthropocentrism that actually takes away from the animal the personhood and individuality that defines this creature. With the EA conference, I felt that there was some people expressed a very radical form of utilitarianism where the individual was basically substituted to a vessel of preferences or possibly suffering or and well-being only. There were some consequences of this. Firstly, the one direct consequence is a very paternalistic approach, especially considering that humans, we do not consider thus. And consequences were also campaign targets that were topics here to some extent as well, like wild animal suffering, where some people seem to consider it our business to intervene and to actually change nature in a way that our values or our thinking about the world determines. So also Peter Singer was in Vienna at his 70th birthday, and he gave a presentation on his philosophy, 40 Years Animal Liberation. This book, I'm a bit astonished that it's called Animal Liberation because it's actually not about liberating animals from human dominance, as the title might suggest, but in, as a matter of fact, it's about minimizing suffering. And as a consequence, he directly said there that vivisection is okay in those exceptional cases where it really reduces suffering overall. Never mind if an individual is sacrificed for that. That is a consequence of this summing and seeing an animal or non-human animal as the vessel for happiness or suffering only. Personhood is a concept that Singer employs as well, but only for humans or special, exceptional non-humans that he considers to be living within time. And those are preserved from this utilitarian calculation. All the non-persons are treated utilitarianly. And if you hear that, you immediately see that utilitarianism alone cannot capture individuality and personhood of beings, of non-human animals. It is reducing them in a large extent. I found this attitude, and I'm not suggesting that Peter Singer is siding with these arguments or anyone else of the CAS or the EA conference, but I experienced this very much in situations concerned with the government of Austria or our animal rights trial that was mentioned in the introduction. There was the debate about whether it's animal abuse to take a mink out of a mink farm cage and put it in the wild. And the question was, if this is animal abuse, not to the animals the mink might hurt, but to the mink him or herself. And there was an expert, a professor of whatever you call this in English, a professor of some kind of form of ethology, who said that it is animal abuse, because in a cage, the animal is being well fed and has water and is not afraid of being preyed on, while in the wild, they constantly have to look for food and are constantly stressed. And this situation says that it's sort of less stressed and there's less suffering in a cage, and so taking the animal into the wild just per se is already animal abuse. Similarly, with the liberation of pigs from a factory farm, there was another expert on farmed animals, and he argued that if you take out pigs and put them on the meadow outside of these factory farms, they actually suffer because inside they have food and shelter and warmth and they know the other animals, whereas outside it's an alien environment for them and they don't know where to get food from and drink, and that stresses them and that makes them suffer. So from a utilitarian calculation, it was argued very directly in these trials, it is actually better to keep them in a cage. So it resounds for me this argument that wild animals are always suffering. They always have to look for their own food and other terrible deals, and therefore we need to actually keep them in a park and feed them and shelter them. It makes it better for them. Actually, the EU vivisection directive has something similar. There is death without suffering, the least damage you can have, even less damage than a needle prick, which also seems to suggest this. And also this broiler initiative of the government argued on a utilitarian calculation. Here you see a broiler shed in Austria, and it is argued that how do we know if these animals suffer? We look at their feet, the cut of feet in the slaughterhouse on the slaughter line, and if the injuries are small, then they don't suffer much, so we don't need to worry and we could put in some more chickens. If the injury is half-sized, then we keep it as it is, and if there is a too big the injuries, then they suffer, and therefore we need to take some chickens out. It's called animal welfare indicators, and it is sold as the new concept of animal welfare, so we don't put in direct measures of so and so many birds per square meter, but we say we look at the damage, and so objectified suffering, and try to minimize that. I feel the background of all this is that non-human animals are not taken seriously. And my comparison is to a dog on a chain. A dog on a chain is not free because the chain ends somewhere. And this is in principle only the restriction of movement. So there is a freedom of movement that is restricted. But freedom per se, is that a problem for this dog? The argument goes that if the dog runs to the end of the chain and then can't go further, you just need to extend the chain, then you reduce the suffering. But you don't need to get rid of the whole chain, because freedom per se is nothing important to the animal. This seems to be, to me, this seems to be the concept behind this. Animals don't have autonomy, don't have free will, don't want to decide anything by themselves, they just don't want to suffer. So they're reduced to this vessel of amounts of suffering or happiness. I think the background to that, again, is this, that we think of it as a scientific approach. There is no metaphysics in it. You don't have to put arbitrary values on this, what is a principle in philosophy or not, but you just count the suffering. Free will, consciousness, subjective feelings, it's all too messy. It needs too much metaphysical assumptions, so we leave it out. And we reduce the whole thing to measurable things like stresses in the blood or stimulus response reactions to the animal. And so you see what is a stimulus that has negative responses, you remove that. And they consider that, or you might consider that, the best approach because it's objective and scientific. I want to argue that this is very wrong. This is not true that this is a way of approaching it objectively, because you deny the most basic quality of non-human animals. As a consequence of this, by the way, I heard that also at this EA conference, is the suggestion that in future, computers will be those creatures that suffer most and we need to look after the most. And that's because people seem to see computers as capable of stimulus response reactions. And so they are included in this, to my view, very strange concept of suffering. As a matter of fact, I will try to argue that computers as such cannot suffer and will never. Firstly, my personal approach to that. I don't want anybody to start reducing my suffering. As a matter of fact, in reality, I want to do activities like rock climbing and ice climbing and sleeping in the snow and challenging ski slopes and also meeting possible predators like wild bears, as I have done very often. I spend a lot of time in the wild as possible. And indeed, I have been hurt very badly already, but I consider that part of life. And I don't want anybody to come to me and save me from this suffering. I want to decide myself, and I want to be free, and that's the most important to me. And that's not just me, that's humans. There's a number of movements or historical facts I could quote where it was very clear that freedom was the most important aspect. Freedom per se, not freedom of bodily harm, freedom of movement, but freedom per se, that you can decide yourself and nobody interferes, even if they are no better. Or a benevolent tyrann who could do it better, really. You still object. Like women liberation, a woman as being part of whatever, a matrimonial situation where she's looked after and doesn't need to work. No, people want to be free, even if that means taking their own responsibility and having to look after themselves. Equal vote doesn't mean reducing suffering. It means taking responsibility and having some say yourself. In this film Matrix, there was this, to my view, abhorrent situation, and to the view of all viewers of the film, where it turned out humans were actually kept in some bubble where they are being fed nutritious things, and then their conscious experience is being produced by some computer matrix that actually plays to them a life that is full of joy and happiness. And from a utilitarian point of view, that would be ideal, without asking them, because they're all very happy. They live in these bubbles, don't realize, and are very happy. But the whole film is about humans who risk life and limb to avoid this scenario. So it seems that humans want freedom and not paternalistic minimization of suffering. I have a very deep relationship with a dog who sadly isn't here, mostly because the travel would have been so far. And I spend a lot of time with him in the wild. And out there, we try to be on an equal relationship. We try to decide together what we're doing, and we try to be completely independent beings. Suffering doesn't play a part of it. Here is my dog friend in the minus 15 degrees, steep, icy slopes. We both suffered, but I can assure you that this is his preference, and this is what he wants to do. Here, my dog friend in a whiteout, or where we spent many days in deep snow. For him, freedom is important. You can see that on many, many aspects of his life. One is that if you put him on a lead, he's very different than he's off the lead. It's a completely different conscious awareness state of him. He knows very well if he's on a lead or not, and that changes completely his situation. And on the one side, he needs to, without the lead, he needs to take responsibility for what he does. And on the lead, he gives the hands over the responsibility to me. But there's a lot of things that we do and experience together. It starts with consensual decisions where we go next. And you can debate that with a dog, and you can decide it. And it seems to me we decided on a very equal footing. There's a steep slope, we want to get over that, and I consider myself climbing there. He does the same. I look over there and I see him, picturing him climbing through and then deciding on this route or that. And it turned out sometimes that he saw these things better and actually chose the route that was doable while I was not. So I needed to come back and follow his path. Also, the play is on equal terms, which is very important. I'm not handing out the rules for his play, but the rules are decided upon together. There's also very clearly seeable that he has values that he's setting himself, and that he has a value system, and in some sense, ethics, as a conclusion of that. For example, the biggest and most important value is preserving our relationship. So if there are other values, like eating something, that is coming below the relationship. Also suffering. He would take suffering in order to preserve our relationship. Or he would hold himself back from lust, like storming over there or hunting this animal, in order to preserve our relationship. So he's very consciously sometimes deciding not doing this or that in order not to jeopardize this or that value of his. And indeed, we have an intense communication without words. I've written a book on our relationship, and it's going to appear in English in a couple of months, maybe. Hopefully in Lantern Book Publications, we will see. And this book shows page after page of the kind of communicational ways and paths we have developed between each other. If you look at the dog brain of my friend and mine, you see that there is a very stark similarity. There is this big brain that is overmantling everything else, which is whatever it's called in English, encephalon or something, I don't know. It's the big brain, and this is the same structure here. You see the brain stem, you see the cerebellum, and these areas where we have the conscious feelings, and then over and above all this is this area of your big brain that is actually used for reflection. If you want, the brain stem is putting your drives into your conscious awareness, the cerebellum is putting your conditioning, the conditioning and the stimulus response reactions into your conscious awareness, and then you check it out with this big brain. Shall I do this or shall I do this not? Does this fit to my value system or does it not? And you tell me, why does a dog have it if he can't do that? Obviously he can. It's the biggest part of his brain. He is like us, reflecting on these things. And there's a number of scientific results that actually support that view. For example, mirror neurons. Dogs have mirror neurons. Mirror neurons have been found in 1992, and they actually fire when there is an activity that this conscious being perceives someone else doing, and the same neurons fire when they are doing it themselves. Like moving the right arm or paw leads to some firing, and if they see someone else moving a right arm or paw, the same neurons fire. And these neurons tell this creature, this is not a stimulus to which I respond, this is a being, and this being has a right arm, and this being is moving the right arm now, and I know what that means because I can do it myself. So there's a lot of reflection going on here, which we usually not allow or accept animals to have. But mirror neurons go even further. They can also tell this being what the aim, what the goal, what the thought behind this or that activity is. They also fire with respect to emotional states that they have or others. These mirror neurons are responsible for feeling empathy. If you see some other being suffering, you feel it yourself. You have this pain in you. And these are the mirror neurons firing. And these neurons exist in all vertebrate animals, in mammals as well as in birds, definitely. So these beings can feel empathy, which is often denied for such beings. And also there are magnetic resonance scans done since 1994, I think, in an American university. These dogs are privately held or were kept for and cared for, and they come just in the university. They are being conditioned to lie still in this scanner, and then there are scans. And these scans show that these beings can also have memory. They can have memories attached to emotions. And so there's sorts of pictures of brain neuron firings that are very similar to humans. So there's actually, from this neurobiological point of view, no reason to think that animals can't feel all this and can't do all this, which are all part of a decision, capability of deciding, and freedom per se, or what you might call free will. One example of my friend, who is called Cooksey, deciding on tofu. I give him a piece of tofu, and it happened, he bit me in his excitement. He took the tofu, And he bit me and I said, ow. But then I give him the next one because I realized this wasn't deliberate. But he and his mirror neurons realize he's hurt me. I don't reprimand him. I even give him the next positive stimulus. If he was a stimulus response machine, he should bite me immediately because this is when you get the tofu. But as a matter of fact, he didn't. He had the mirror neuron firing that told him this guy's having pain. He had the value system that told him this is my friend. I don't want to hurt him. And he had the reflection of thinking, I'm not going to hurt him again. Next thing is he grabs the tofu very carefully with his big incisor teeth, just tiny touch and taking it very lightly from me. So there was very obviously a very conscious decision against his inner drives, be they genetically programmed or be they conditioned. Self-awareness is something, an ability of him that he definitely has. In my relationship with him, I say this is definitely the case. The classic proof of doing this is the so-called mirror self-recognition, where you put an animal in front of a mirror and paint a little bit on the nose, and if this animal then touches the nose in the mirror, it's proof that the animal is recognizing him or herself in the mirror. Indeed, this sort of thing he is not doing. If I paint his face, he ignores that completely. But it might well be that he just ignores visual signs of other beings. My girlfriend then had a wasp that has stung her a few times in the face, and she was grotesquely distorted. And he treated her like if she was looking like that always. So apparently, he doesn't distinguish that. There's some other trigger that is more important for him. That's the nose. And indeed, you can prove that animals, that dogs recognize their own smell very clearly. There is a long-going experiment by Mark Beckhoff, this very well-known and animal rights sympathetic ethologist. He gathered urine of dogs for decades, I think, and then just kept giving that to them and see how they react. But as a matter of fact, these magnetic resonance scans prove it, because the animal was sitting in the scan and having the brain scanned, and at the same time was given smells. And there was the smell of an alien dog, and the brain was rattling on, oh God, what is that? Age, what was the health status, what was the gender, what was the sex of the dog, and what state was it emotionally, blah, 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 blah. Lots of things happening. Also, if there's an alien human, it's a bit less interesting, but still lots of rattling on. Then there is known humans. There's a lot less activity, also with known dogs. They seem to be recognized and categorized. This is this guy, zack, gone. And now the brain's finished analyzing. I know that smell. And then the smell of himself. And he ignores it completely. Smell is there and it's blank. I know that. That's me. So very obviously, this creature can recognize himself. Not in the mirror, maybe, but from a smell. Indeed, mirrors, they do understand. I've done experiments with my dog friend. We put him in front of a mirror, and there was a blind in between me and him. And then I showed him little treats and put them somewhere here, and then I said, now get them. And then he watched me in the mirror and then ran over and got them immediately. And that's also known from other ethological studies. They can use mirrors in order to solve problems. And he sees himself in the mirror and doesn't say, what dog is that? But he says, he must think something like, it's me, I don't need to care, because he doesn't care when he sees himself in the mirror. Then self-awareness surely plays a big role when he is on the lead or not, or when he is in the car that is on a security belt or not. On a security belt, he can't go out, so if I open the door, he doesn't go out. He doesn't go to the end and then says, hoppala, I am on this thing. No, no. He sits and waits till you open it. And sometimes I forget that I've put him on a security belt. I say, come out, and he's sitting. I say, come out, I haven't got ages. He's sitting there. I think, what's the matter with you? Then I realize I've put him on a belt. He is fully aware after 10 hours drive that he is on a belt, and he can't move himself. And especially on the lead, when you walk the road, it's so different, so different. The best little story to that is that I had a colleague at our office in Vienna who was walking with him in the streets, and I was never there, so they walked together. And sometimes I walked, or often every day I walk with him. And I always walk with him without a lead. I fully trust him in the traffic and wherever, and with other dogs. He is completely under control himself. He's walking on a pavement, there's a dog on the other side of the pavement. He doesn't run over if there's no cars. He runs if there are cars, he runs over if there are no cars. So he's very much under control of himself. But when I met this guy again and we talked about walking with the dog, and he said he's a very friendly dog, but there's one problem. He attacks every other dog like mad. And I said, what? I've never seen him attack a dog, never. And then we talked a bit and I realized he's on the lead with my colleague. And when he's on the lead, I can try that. He attacks every dog. And why does he do that? Because he hands over responsibility to me. He just attacks, he screams around, I'm a big guy, blah, blah, blah. And if there is no lead, then he's responsible. If he attacks the dog, he will get bitten or whatever. So he's responsible and he becomes a friendly guy who signals, I'm a friendly guy. And he might ignore the guy, this other dog, or go there, or whatever. So he takes responsibility, and this is 100-0. This is just so obvious that nobody can question that. He also recognizes my suffering. There's no doubt about this. We know this about the mirrors, but it has happened to me. I have been injured in front of him in the wild. He comes over, he comforts me, he tries to help me. He is very concerned when I'm hurt. Also, when I'm sad, I'm sitting in the forest and crying, maybe he will come over, he will lick my hand, he will comfort me. Everybody living with a dog knows that. So he does recognize pain in others. He's not a stimulus response machine. And he then acts correspondingly. He has also oxytocin, this binding hormone, pushing it out like humans are. So there is a very similar subjective experience of discomforting as well. He helps me in danger when a tree fell over and I was underneath it. He came and tried to pull me out. And funny also, I read in the New Scientist that proof of young human children is of their self-awareness is when they yawn, when you yawn, this contagious yawning. And indeed he does that. I tried it when I read that. I tried it yawning 3 times in front of him. He starts yawning as well. It's the mirror neurons, obviously, because he sees me yawning, the mirror neurons fire, yawning, and then he yawns himself like we experience as well. And if New Scientist says that proves self-awareness, so be it. Indeed, there's a very big difference between conditioning and understanding, conscious understanding. It's located in very different areas when you watch the brain firing. You see that the conditioning is happening in the small brain, in the cerebellum, whereas learning, conscious learning, needs a lot of the large brain. I was, for 12 years, a mathematics lecturer at the university and a researcher. And I did do lectures and I did do exams. And the primary focus of an exam in mathematics is finding out if this person to be tested has actually learned this thing by heart or understands it. And you try that by posing different the problem in different versions and see whether they understand the concept or whether they just try to look for a stimulus response and then spit it out. So there is clear possibility of distinguishing those. And I can see that with my dog friend. Indeed, ethological studies always look for the clever Hans effect, which is the stimulus response. And indeed, the learning should, if it's interesting ethologically, then it must be a conscious learning on a very different level. One example to see that is game of chess here. A chess example, I'm not sure how familiar you are to this, but you see, if you look at it briefly, and if you know a bit about chess, then you know that, whatever this is in English, how do you call it? Knight, do you? Knight, if you push this knight up over there. Bishop, yeah. If you put it up there, then it's a draw, because this is this line of pawns, probably, that this other guy can't pull through. But you're very tempted to take this, whatever it's called, tower? No. Sorry? Rock. Okay, yeah. So you see, understanding it or blind trial and error and conditioning and learning by heart rules is a very different matter. And I have a mathematical proof for that. There is an Austrian guy called Kurt Gödel. He's dead already. He died in the 70s. And he did probably the most important mathematical theorem. And I very briefly tell you that before you all run away. He proved that for any set of axioms, which are these basic statements that you just introduced via convention. There is always a mathematical theorem that I, the person who followed the proof, can recognize to be true, definitely true, but it cannot be proven with this axiom. So he basically proved this mathematical insight that there is, it is not possible to devise by convention a set of rules that leads to the proof of the truth of all mathematical theorems. And that shows that there is a mathematical, in his view at least, and I support that, there is a mathematical objective truth independent of human conventions. And indeed, a guy called Alan Turing in England redid this theorem with application to computers. He developed this idea of computing. And from his proof, you can basically read off that consciousness cannot be a computer code or be completely simulated by a computer, because however you devise this computational algorithm, it can never prove all mathematical theorems that I understand to be true. So my functioning of understanding truth cannot be captured by a computer code. In mathematics, you can prove that so clearly, which is the value of mathematics, but it is applicable, in my view, to all understanding outside of mathematics as well. Consciousness is not a computer code. And this is my argument why computers cannot suffer. And basically the consequences of this Gödel theorem is that the conscious mind is more than a computer, while still being a physical state of a physical system, that this behaviorism idea of stimulus response is obsolete when it comes to conscious being, and that any conscious being has a free will in that sense, that it can find truths independently of such automatic reactions of stimulus response. Interestingly, I claim Descartes, this anti-animal guy that we often hear of, as in support of my view. Because Descartes argued, in essence, that animals cannot be feeling anything because they haven't got free will, they haven't reasoned, they can't decide things, they can't consciously decide things, so they cannot have conscious feelings. But what for have conscious feelings if you can't decide upon them? Because otherwise these conscious feelings are just hassling you, but the decision is made anyway. So you just follow whatever the computer code in you is telling you, so then you don't need a conscious feeling. And I turn this around. There is this Cambridge Declaration from 2012 of a neurobiological conference that said vertebrate animals, actually do have subjective feelings and a consciousness. And if this is the case, the only reason for that can be that they have a free will on which to decide things. You could argue that also from an evolutionary point of view, consciousness needs a lot of energy. A conscious decision takes time. You must think about it and then you decide. The automatic stimulus response thing, the computer code learning type of thing, is automatic and very fast and without using energy. But you do use energy for a conscious decision, and you need sleep to recover from this work and also to restore the energy and to put these experiences you had consciously in context. So actually, for me, that proves evolutionary that there must be some autonomy attached to consciousness, because the only reason why consciousness can have developed evolutionary is through its effect on acting. And this effect on acting I call autonomy. And the ethical consequences of this is that any being with consciousness has indeed the ability to decide freely and therefore values his or her freedom per se, and not just the freedom to move and the freedom of bodily harm, but the freedom per se. Conscious creatures are beings that want to be self-determined and want to decide by themselves, and they don't want paternalistic decisions over their heads. So the vision is that we have a society where we allow as many conscious beings as possible, as much free decisions as possible. And I would also quote Kimlichka Donaldson for their Zoopolis book, and use that vision for extending it to so-called domesticated animals who might not be able to completely live autonomously, but autonomous in a direct relation to humans, like my dog friend does, and see for that the vision of a multi-species society where we actually keep space and leave space for as autonomous as possible animals who are living with us. In essence, what I'm what I want to argue for is that we see not just animal welfare and making the situation better and minimizing suffering as a goal for our campaigns, but animal liberation, liberating animals from human dominance. This is our primary, my primary goal in my campaigns, and I evaluate the campaign quality of how much society, if we are successful, moves in this direction. So I see campaigns as a very political thing, and I see animal rights as a tool towards liberation. But I mean this liberation literally, in the sense that for a social liberation, we need also dogs to be off the lead. Being on a lead is not free. So we need to have a society where dogs can be off the lead. This is part of my vision of liberation. And surely the method still remains the same as I've argued before, even with such an abolitionist goal of the end of human dominance, that we must change the system step by step towards ever more autonomy for those beings. And briefly at the end, I want to show you that book that I've written and that is going to come out in a couple of months, hopefully. It has been already finished translation, it's just a matter of getting it published. The Dog and His Philosopher, it's called, and half of it deals about my relationship with my dog friend to explain it, this kind of relationship out in the wilderness, and the other half is applying it to a philosophical discourse that leads to this claim of autonomy for non-human animals. And as a very last thing, I want to remind you that this action is coming up in Vienna on the 5th of November, if you haven't registered yet and want to join us with this vigil with dead animals like here in Madrid. I invite you to do so. Thank you for listening.
I have a question about this wild animal suffering or intervention in nature. So I would also value autonomy, but the bad things that happen in nature, the starvation, parasites, predation, these are all things that violate autonomy in my point of view. Huh? So if you're dead, where is your autonomy if you're dead? So are you in favor of intervening in nature in order to improve autonomy of all living beings, which means avoiding predation, starvation, things like that?
No, I would argue that you should leave wildlife as free, as self-determined as possible. I would compare that to avalanches. I'm going through mountainous areas in the winter, and there are avalanches. Yes, if they kill me, I lose my autonomy, but this is part of the deal. If you want to be free and out, then this is what's happening. If you might say, better we go there and blow up all these potential avalanches and let the snow go down, and then everybody can walk safely. But I wouldn't want to be in a wilderness of that kind. You might say, we glue all the rocks to the rock faces before I climb up so that no rocks will fall on me, as they did. But I wouldn't want to be in such a wilderness. And you might say, lightning strike kills humans. In Austria, 4 people a year. We might put a big glass thing above it and then avoid lightnings, and there's less suffering and less death. I wouldn't want to be in such a wilderness. Wilderness means there is this kind of danger and there's this kind of activity in this part of it. There might be exceptions to this, like when there is huge starvations because of something, and then there might be a catastrophe where you help. And also individually, if there is a being that sort of I meet in the wilderness and that at that moment needs help. But predation I see on an equal footing with an avalanche. This is not an ethical question to me. If there is this kind of conflict, it's not an ethical question. The same for me, you know, if a bear eats me, I don't want the bear to be killed and shot or whatever. I say this is part of the deal. I am deliberately going in areas where there are bears that potentially kill me. And I have met bears. And this is part of it. I want to be in a wilderness where there are bears that potentially kill me. And if they kill me, I wouldn't change my mind. It's too late then anyway. But I tell you now, let me be eaten by a bear and not remove the bears. I want to be rather eaten by a bear and be in the wilderness than not.
Yeah, thank you very much. I have a bit of a problem with this undifferentiated consciousness. We all run into these discussions about consciousness and then, you know, how much of consciousness is required to be autonomous, for example. Is a baby, because it has, what degree does a baby have consciousness, or a puppy, and to what extent, at what point do you allow that consciousness to become, to be translated into autonomy?
I would say immediately. But this concept of autonomy is a continuous one. There's not complete autonomy, never is. I'm not completely autonomous, nobody is. And I find that is the mistake of Immanuel Kant. His ethics is trying to be devoid of metaphysics, which is this cool idea. But he actually comes from the premise that we're all made by a God who actually gives us autonomy. And then you have full autonomy or none. This is also why Descartes made this mistake of thinking animals can't have autonomy, because they don't act reasonably all the time, but might be sometimes a little bit. But as a matter of fact, I think with the first conscious experience, the simplest conscious experience, which might be toothache, which is very strong for me, and anyway, with bad teeth, there's a very strong conscious awareness. If you have strong toothache, there's nothing but toothache. You don't see anything, you don't feel anything, you don't hear anything, there's only this toothache. And this subjective, this simplest form of consciousness, this kind of subjective feeling, is basis of an autonomous decision. I have toothache, and therefore I do this or that or that. This subjective feeling enables this conscious decision. And be it very limited, because there's not much I can do, be it very limited, because I haven't got a big, very big brain that has lots of alternatives that is suggesting to me, it might be small alternatives, and I haven't got many abilities, so maybe my autonomy is restricted, and I might not understand everything around me, so my autonomous decision might be not the best. But nevertheless, with the tiniest bit of consciousness comes a tiny bit of autonomy or ability of free decisions. And that is, in my view, necessary, because consciousness will have developed in evolution with a tiny bit. There must have been the first sort of subjective awakening ones. And that must have had an advantage in order to sustain this disadvantage of costing so much energy. And this advantage must have been that this being with the tiny bit of consciousness was able to a tiny autonomous decision that is distinct from a drive or a conditioning, a stimulus response reaction, a computer code reaction. And so so I think with the tiny bit of consciousness, this comes, this is a corresponding ability.
Yes. My question is the relationship to a dog friend is a very symbiotic one. And it's an exception in that regard. And perhaps you can say something. I fully agree on the aim you go to with your examples, what you want to illustrate. But there are many examples where the interests of those, the freedom interests of those self-conscious animals conflict with human interests. And what can we on the great scale do to motivate human beings to give other beings also the necessary autonomy? That's the motivation drive, where shall we take it in that time?
Yeah, I mean, obviously very difficult question, or very difficult goal. I mean, if there was no conflict of our value system, with the value system of other conscious beings, then ethics would be easy. Everybody does what they want to do and leave them do it. There's only a conflict starting where I want to do something that someone else wants to do as well, and we can't do it both. And this is where the ethical conflict starts, and this is where you start to need either utilitarian calculations, if it's not down to some being with rights, but some other values like nature or whatever, there's utilitarian calculation maybe. And on the other hand, if there is a right holder, then you have to ask yourself what is the most important right and which one is overridden first. And so there are conflicts and there are sort of real conflicts. And the question is always how to resolve them. In society, we have some tactics, some methods of doing this, also for beings who can't express themselves politically, like maybe humans who have, for whatever reason, not the capability of doing this. There must be somebody in there who represents their interests. And obviously, nothing works ideal in society, but there are ideas and there are methods of doing this, like having a legal representative of you in court, because you or me or whoever might not be capable of representing ourselves. And we could try to use that model for representing non-human animals. Like if there is a road project and there are rabbits living there, there must be some sort of political procedure that allows both interests. So maybe the road is built somewhere else, or the road is built a bit and there is another place for the rabbits to go. But you know, there needs to be that deal. And that is not happening at all. Today we are saying utilitarianism, and there is a different version, obviously, of those people who are doing it from an animal point of view, or those that are actually representing the state. But there's utilitarian calculation. How much do they suffer, and then how do they suffer less, maybe? And then there is this stressor and stimulus response calculation. And the animals always lose out in this. They haven't got rights, so they lose out with respect to humans with rights. So, but I mean, it should be possible to have some methods, but obviously who knows how that works and how will it ever work. But I mean, this is a vision. And there's politics, and there might be very different matters. But what we need to do is try to develop these methods and try to more and more represent political interests of non-human animals in society and represent them in court, which is why we did a campaign for an animal solicitor scheme, so that in Austria there are now 9 animal solicitors appointed that can, in animal abuse cases, represent animals in court. We have a scheme where, or we're trying to think up schemes where they are in some sense represented in decisions on if some activity like a theater where animals on it are allowed, should be allowed or should not be allowed. So there are animal solicitors who can intervene on behalf of animals, but we need to develop that scheme a lot more. Only in Switzerland, as far as I know, has ever been somebody representing animals in criminal trials as victims. But this has been abolished again. So Antoine Goetschel. So we see if there is a possibility for that. But I think this is where we need to go, represent animals in society politically.
Yeah. So you said that you were willing to accept the risks of avalanches and bear attacks. But isn't it arrogant to ask that everyone else has to accept those same risks? Isn't it a violation of their autonomy that they have to face the same problems? You're willing to risk the problem of an avalanche, but demand that I have to accept this risk as well? Isn't this violation of my autonomy?
Now, you don't need to go there where there are avalanches. I mean,
yeah, you know, in the wild.
In here there are none. So in here there are none. If you don't want to have them, stay here. But you're probably saying this chamois is on this avalanche slope and we need to remove the avalanche because we can't ask the chamois. But in some sense, we can ask them. And there are animals who actually come to humans and start joining what they do. But there are good reasons to avoid humans. And I think a chamois is doing better to avoid a human and face the challenge of an avalanche than the other way around.
So where do the prey have to go?
Sorry?
Where do the prey animals have to go? They don't have to go to
which animals?
The prey animals, the zebras.
The prey.
They don't have to go to the lions. But yeah, I know that. But where do they go?
The animals that are being preyed on, you mean?
Yeah.
Okay. At the moment they are being hunted by humans, which is in every respect worse. I can argue for that, and I'd love to. I mean, actually, I've tried to set up a discussion forum. Maybe it happens tomorrow at 6 p.m. I hope you would come and we can then exchange ideas. I have a lot to say about this. We have a hunting campaign, for example, now, which is actually in contradiction to what I hear of some people who follow your line of reasoning would argue. Because hunters that I am dealing with in my campaign, or in our campaign, actually argue that these poor animals should have no predators, so they were exterminated, then they should be not scared of humans and cars, so there's a fence around it, and since there are sometimes too many, we shoot them quickly. Anyway, it's a very quick death. This is how hunters argue, and this is what I hear people argue who say we need to protect wildlife from themselves or from each other. I think the wildlife is faring better if you leave them out and no human goes there. This is my view.
I think I'll try to keep short. I found it really interesting that you mentioned mathematics in order to argue for your point. So you said that Alan Turing would have proven that a computer isn't able to find mathematical proofs. But I think Alan Turing just proved that a Turing machine, which is the standard computer model in theoretical computer science, cannot find all the proofs. But this is what humans also cannot. What humans do in mathematics is to guess some proofs and then to verify them. And this is exactly what a Turing machine can do as well. And for example, you were talking about that computers are different from humans because computers have this program which is fixed. But for example, have you heard of this Google computer which was programmed to play Go? And this computer won against the champion of Go, and they had to change the computer, the programming philosophy, because they were not able to program a fixed program which would make an algorithm to search for all those possibilities, which are too many in Go, but the program learns. And it took much time to learn, for the program plays against itself, and then it learns what good moves are, what bad moves are, and then it gets some intuition. And this is maybe something you are also talking about when you're talking about animals. So, you know what I mean?
Yeah, but I completely disagree in as much as I can possibly express. The point is, you know, that there is a fixed code without learning, say. And that might correspond to animals that have fixed program genetic code and no conscious awareness, because they just the code runs and whatever. The code is sort of evolutionary evolved to try to solve a number of problems, and then it might suit to some extent or not. And then in evolution, something happened that Konrad Lorenz found, that sometimes this code is breaking open and there is a possibility of reading information from outside and then is reprogramming it in other directions. This is the stimulus response machine that is able to learn via conditioning. And yes, capable of learning computer programs like this Google machine can do this sort of thing. But Alan Turing is going a step further. There's no heuristic assumption there. Alan Turing has redevised Gödel's theorem in the following phrase: whatever algorithm you take, and even Google is an algorithm, somebody programmed it, so it must be an algorithm. If, then, why, what, blah, blah. Any algorithm of any kind, even an algorithm with infinitely many statements, cannot capture, in principle, cannot prove all mathematical theorems that I myself can understand to be true. This is Alan Turing's claim, and mathematics has accepted that. There's nobody on the planet who says the proof is wrong. I can show you the proof, you will understand it, or you read it yourself. There's a number of publications where it is explained in different versions, but this is definitely true. This is mathematically proven true. An algorithm cannot, even an infinitely long, learnable, capable of learning algorithm can do, can prove statements that I understand to be true. And that shows to me that consciousness by itself cannot be simulated by computer code.